This is the AZ-104-T00A Microsoft Azure Administrator course. And this is something about me. My name is Mohit Kakkar. These are some of my current active batches. I've got MCSC, MCP, MCSA, and I recently got the Microsoft Certified Trainer as well. I'm working here with Quinix Solutions Private Limited. I've got an overall of 10 plus years of experience in various IT technologies with spans to IaaS, PaaS, and SaaS in the cloud. This is the cloud administrator role here. The cloud administrator manages the cloud services that span storage, networking, and compute cloud capabilities with a deep understanding of each service across the full IT lifecycle. They take end user requests for new cloud applications and make recommendations of services to use for optimal performance and scale, as well as provision capacity, monitor, and adjust as appropriate. This role requires communicating with and coordinating with vendors. Cloud admins use the portal as they become more proficient. They would use PowerShell command line interface. Successful cloud administrators start this role with some kind of experience on operating system, virtualization, cloud infra, storage structures, and networking. That is something about the cloud administrator role here. Then we're talking about the prerequisites of this course. So successful Azure administrators start this role with experience on operating system, virtualization, cloud infrastructure, structures, and networking. If you have the understanding of on-premises virtualization technology, which includes VM, virtual networking, virtual hard disk, that would be awesome. Understanding of network configurations like TCP, IP, DNS, virtual private network, firewall, and encryption technology would definitely be a plus here. Understanding of Active Directory concepts such as users, groups, and role-based access control is a mandate. And understanding of resilience and disaster recovery, including backup and restore operation, would really help you out to understand this course even better. These are the 11 modules that we are going to cover in the span of 4 days. So we've got identity, governance and compliance, Azure administration, virtual networking, inter-site connectivity, network traffic management, Azure storage, Azure virtual machine, serverless computing, data protection, and monitoring. So that means we are going to cover 3 modules a day, at least. These are some of the prerequisites which are there. Understanding of on-premises virtual technology. This is something that we have discussed already. These are the certification areas. If you're going for the certification right after taking this course, this is the percentage for the same. Managing Azure identities and governance would take 15 to 20% of weightage. Implementing and managing storage would take 10 to 15%. Deploying and managing Azure compute resources would take 25 to 30%. Virtual networking would take 30 to 35%. Add monitoring and backup would take 10 to 15% of the weightage. That means if you go for the exam, that would be a 1,000 marks exam. You have to secure 700 marks and more, that's 70%. And out of that, 30 to 35% of the questions would come from virtual network. This is the Microsoft certification hierarchy. So first you have to appear for AZ-900. That's the Microsoft Azure Fundamental course. Then you go for 104, which is the Azure Administrator Associate course. And then you go to Solution Expert Architect sessions, which are AZ-303 and 304. These are the hands-on labs. You would get a Microsoft Learning Azure Pass, which provide you access to Microsoft Azure. It would give you a $100 balance and a 30-day validity, whichever expires first. You need to check the dollar balance of the Azure Pass within Microsoft Azure once you have set up your subscription. Be aware of how much you are consuming and do not allow Microsoft Azure components to run overnight for extended periods of time. Lab instructions would be given in the GitHub. I'll share that with you. And each lab creates a new resource group. To minimize the cost, remove the resource group at the end of the lab. And these are some of the additional resources which are there. We've got Azure documentation, Azure forum, Tuesdays with Corey, Channel 9, Microsoft Azure blogs, Learn Pace Labs, and Learning Community blog. These are all available online. You could use them for free of services for learning. So that was a demo module. Let's go on the module number one here. This is regarding the identity. And these are the lessons that we're going to cover. So what is Azure Active Directory here? It says a cloud-based suite of identity management capabilities that enables you to securely manage access to Azure services and resources for your users, which provides application management, authentication, device management, and hybrid identity. Then we've got some Azure AD concepts like identity account, Azure AD account, Azure tenant, directory subscriptions. After that, it is talking about the AGDS versus the Azure Active Directory difference. Then the additions which came in for Azure Active Directory, Azure AD join, multi-factor authentication, self-service password reset. These are some of the features, or you could say the premium features. And then goes to lesson number two for users and groups. This is called the logical architecture of Azure. What is the logical architecture of Azure here? Let's check that out. So we use an account to sign up to Azure. Let's say that account is portal.azure.com. Now I'll go back in the search window. Here I would see this is my account that I used to sign up. This is a Gmail account right here. Now this becomes my Azure account. So I log in with Azure account. What is my account? My account is mohitkakkar100@gmail.com. When I sign up with the account, I would get a subscription. Like I have a MSDN platform subscription. When you would sign up, you would have a Azure free subscription. So I sign up with the subscription name. Under that subscription, I would be creating my resource group. Under that, I would be creating the resource. Let's see what that is. So got my Azure account here. Under that, I've got my subscription. And under that, I've got my resources. So let's take an example here. Like, you know, we have chosen the Azure account as mohitkakkar100@gmail.com. Let's say that we sign up for a subscription also. Let's say that is subscription number one. So let's say this is subscription number one that we signed up for. Now, under the subscription, I would create something which is called my resource group. This is nothing but a container which would hold my resources. What resources are there? The resources could be anything. It could be a VM. It could be a DB. It could be a storage. It could be a SQL. Right? It could be a virtual network, a VPN gateway, anything of that sort. That would, all of that which you create in Azure is called a resource. And it would be kept under a resource group. So resource group is nothing but grouping of the resources. So when you would be creating a resource group, it would be asking you certain questions over here. What are those questions? First of all, it would be asking you what is the subscription that you want to create this resource group into. So I would say the subscription is subscription number one. I only have one subscription. Then it would ask me the name of the resource group. Let's say I gave it a name RG1. Then it would ask me to give the region of the resource group. I would say that it is East US. Now, how many people know about what a region is? Can anybody define me a region? You could unmute yourself area. And it's a geographic area, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So if we go here.
Can we also say that it's a geographical region where we have a set of data centers where the
resources? Absolutely. You could definitely say that. When I go to Azure Regions, the first link that I click here would tell me geographically how many data centers are there. If I click on India, it tells me that I've got three data centers, Pune, Chennai, and Mumbai. Or you could say three regions. In one region, there could be multiple data centers as well. So where is it? It's Central India, South India, and West India. The exact locations are Pune, Chennai, and Mumbai. Similarly, if I want to see another geography, let's say Africa, it says there is only one, which is called as South Africa North, and it is in location Johannesburg. Similarly, if I go for, let's say, Australia, it is telling me that there are three: Australia Central, Australia East, Australia Southeast, Canberra, New South Wales, and Victoria. Right. So this is where your set of multiple data centers or one data center would be lying. But at least one would be lying in each region. So now I know here that this is the East US. That means if I go back here in United States, I would see East US is in Virginia. So basically that means I am creating my resources in Virginia. So I go ahead and create a resource group subscription number one, RG1, and in East US. After that, I could create any resource, VM, DBs, STRG, storage account, SQL, VNet, VPN gateway. Now, whenever I would create that, it would ask me some number of questions when I create a resource. What are those number of questions? Again, the first question would be, what is the type of resource that you're creating? So let's say I say I want to create a VM. Again, it would ask me again subscription. I would say subscription number one. Again, it would ask me RG. I would say RG1. And I would define here East US. Or it would be automatically selected, doesn't matter. Again, it would ask me the name of my virtual machine or my resource. I would say VM1. And again, it would ask me the region of that resource. So I would say East US, West US, anything. Now the question comes, I've got here RG1 in East US. I got here RG1 in East US. And I've deployed this VM or a VM1 in East US itself. Now, can I deploy another VM, maybe a VM2, let's say, in West US? Is it possible? What do you guys think?
I think no.
You can just create a second domain.
Okay. So the answer to that question is yes, you can do that. So the resource group and the resources are not interdependent on each other when we talk about the location. So the resource group could be in East US, but the resources could be in East US or West US. Now again, the East US and West US would be in the same geography for America. What about if I go ahead and say I've got a DB here in South Europe or in West Europe? Is this possible?
If you have connection, it's possible.
So yes, you could even create in different geographies like West Europe, or maybe you want to create a resource, let's say a different resource altogether, let's say a VNet one in South India. So even if there is no connection between these resources, even if you want to create something entirely in Africa or some other region, then in that case you could create that and you could keep it under your resource group number one. So the question comes, if they have no relation when it comes to this location, then why do we have to mention the location separately for a resource group when we are already signifying it in the resource? Why do we need to do it separately and there is no connection in the location?
Traffic optimization.
I'm sorry,
I meant traffic optimization.
Traffic optimization. Okay, what does that supposed to mean?
Well, basically, we have a virtual machine in one location, database in second. Then you need to have some root processor, yes?
No. So, okay. I just gave it an example. That does not mean that, you know, this virtual machine needs to be connected to this database. I just give you an example so that, you know, different resources could be created. This could be anything else. Let's say this could be a VPN gateway and it has no connection or no need of a connection here, right? So it doesn't mean that it has to connect to each other in a group. They have to only connect to each other. There is no such condition like that. The reason why we have to specify this resource group location is because of something which is called as a metadata. And what is metadata? Metadata is nothing but information about your resources or about your resource that you have deployed, right? So it provides you the information file for that. So Microsoft says if you are under a compliance which does not let you take your metadata out of your country or out of your location, let's say Australia or Europe or something like that, then in that case, you could choose where you want to keep your metadata file as well. I hope that one is clear here. So we've got the Azure account, we've got the subscription, we've got the resource group, and we've got the resources. Now there is something else as well here on top of this, which is called as a management group. Now, what is this management group?
Group of administrators.
I'm sorry, can you repeat that once?
The group for administrator.
The group for administrators. No, yep. Not really. This is to apply the policies at scale and to manage multiple subscriptions. Let's take an example. Let's say I've got a company here. Let's say I've got Facebook root management group here. So I've got a Facebook root management group here. Let's say it is divided into three management groups. So let's say I've got here a HR management group, let's say a marketing, let's say I've got a IT. Now let's say this HR management group is further divided into two management groups. This could be a HR India. This could be a HR US. And further, I've got two subscriptions here. And I've got three subscriptions here. Now, there could be a possibility that we want to apply a policy. And maybe that policy I want to apply on the entire organization. So what I could do is I could apply that policy right here on Facebook root management group. In that case, it would go from top to bottom and it would apply on the entire organization.